This is the engine room of the swing bridge in Newcastle. This is the main power plant of the bridge. It's all original, made by Armstrong around about 1873. The bridge itself was opened in 1876. July the 17th, it opened without ceremony. Armstrong was a great gunmaker, and he had quite a problem in the fact that his main factory was about 3 miles outside of the city of Newcastle, at a little village called Elswick. All his armaments had to be transported by horse and cart, and it would be greatly advantageous to him to be able to take his vessels up to be armed at his factory. Armstrong got two benefits from this. He would get the benefit of being able to have his vessels that he was arming at his factory. He also got a massive advert. It cost roughly £253,000 at that time, which was quite a bit of money, I would imagine. Seeing that the Tyne is a very weather-beaten place, it's resisted quite well, and it's lasted for over 120 years. Anyone who's interested in Armstrong's work not only visits Cragside but comes down to the swing bridge in Newcastle. We have all walks of life come onto the bridge. We've had engineers from all over the world. And we get quite a few TV personalities in. The people who turn up unannounced are told quite categorically that the public isn't admitted, and they're asked to leave. We try to keep this place spick and span, and one of the things I don't like is people coming in here and standing on my brass. Somebody came in here and said to me, we're going to replace it with something new. I would not be happy. Look at what we're losing. This, just the beauty. This has got a guaranteed life of evermore.
The previous bridge on this site had been designed in the 1770s by Robert Milne, who was both engineer and architect. A century later, such a combination was unthinkable. Engineering was one thing, architecture quite another. This was a division born out of the iniquitous white-collar conspiracy called professions. The bridges across the Tyne, the icons which define Newcastle, are engineering, not architecture. That's because they're practical, everyday working structures, all rolled up sleeves and the reek of Swarfiga.
Now let's look at another bridge which Armstrong built. This one crosses the Ouseburn and was erected when Jesmond Dean was still his private domain, a place of privacy, recreation and gentility.
A place where a mere girder bridge would appear unacceptably underdressed. So as we approach it, we're not apprised of the bridge's metal structure. We're led to believe that it's of stone. A material which, even by an engineer, was adjudged superior to, or more respectable, than wrought iron. This fakery, for the sake of propriety, would be endlessly repeated at Cragside. Norman Shaw was a voluble opponent of the idea that architecture should be considered a profession, and he tacitly accepted the separation of architecture and engineering in his dealings with Armstrong. Shaw's conviction was that architecture could never be a profession because it was an art, and that the two were mutually irreconcilable. Given his own qualities, his brilliance as a perspectivist and his preoccupation with appearance rather than with structure, it's hardly surprising that this should be the way he conceived of architecture in general.
Armstrong and Shaw, patron and architect, engineer and artist, were, for different reasons, of the same opinion, that architecture is a disguise worn by engineering, that it exists independently of structure, that it does not express form, but rather that it expresses mood, sentiment, personality.
The precept of truth to materials, one of the high Victorian shibboleths, interested neither man, again for different reasons.
So there existed a happy unanimity, sort of. Cragside displays peculiar tensions. Whatever wholeness, whatever integrity it may possess, is only skin deep. The place is actually a mass of contradictions.
It seldom suggests elisions or harmony or joined up thinking. It feels, and indeed was, sutured together. It's compartmentalised. Its parts make a whole, but only just. Which is apt enough, for after all, the man who paid for it was, if you like, simultaneously several men.
And the man who designed it was prone to mutation throughout his long career. Consistency is no more a virtue than is purity.
This was originally a sporting estate, a place where humans congregate around one of their number who is rich enough to have bought thousands of acres.
And there to stalk, to fish, to shoot.
And to dress according to what species they're going to kill. In hunting pink, for instance, which is usually red, but may look black to viewers without the blue button.
Recreational slaughter is obviously quite unnecessary so far as sustenance is concerned. And anyway, few of us today still eat fox, not least because it tastes like dog.
That, however, is to miss the point. Just as hunts themselves miss the point when they feebly claim that their purpose is vermin control. That's a pathetic excuse. Hunts don't need excuses to justify their existence. The point, surely, is that they're an admission that humankind, no matter how civilized and urbane it believes itself to be, is prey to primitive urges, and that certain of those urges are best expressed in the country.
Country is an incitement to hunter-gathering, to savagery, to bestiality. The city is an incitement to intoxication and same-species sex. Cities create sites of toleration specific to the discharge of those urges. Cities temper urges by means of ritual.
And the country does the same. Great estates ritualize the forms of primitivism peculiar to bucolic life. The country and the city are engaged in the same programme of controlled licence. This is a concept which tyrants who would sooner invade distant lands are incapable of recognising.
Going fishing and mortally harming a tench whilst reading a copy of Beaver Life is a healthier, if less macho, way of succumbing to that urge than shooting a toothless old woman through the back of her head in a town which you've never heard of and whose name you can't pronounce. Armstrong caused as many fish, bird, and animal deaths as he did human deaths.
Lord Armstrong was a very keen fisherman. I think in his earliest days he really got hooked on it. He obviously was very keen, so coming up here and fishing in, well, you can imagine the sort of surroundings you're fishing in. You know, it's really beautiful. And he eventually ended up building a house on the estate and got into the fishing shooting. He was just a very, very keen all-round sportsman. These days, trout and the salmon's declining, but in Lord Armstrong's day, it would be actually teeming with them. If he had people come to the house, he would just get his fish for whatever day he wanted, so they'd never be short of a fish for the table. I think if poachers had been caught in Lord Armstrong's time, it would have been a lot more severe than what it is now. You certainly wouldn't be getting a little reprimand and maybe your tackle confiscated. I wouldn't like to say what I think would be happening really, but I don't think they'd be out fishing the next day, put it that way.
The house's function as a temple, if you like, at the centre of these rural rituals was not abandoned. It was added to. The house acquired further functions.
No one bothered. I'm happy on a survey. I'm misbehaving.
One of the strange additions to the house, beneath the library, Lord Armstrong had a Turkish bath installed. He'd sit in a room, a dry heat area, and sweat out the grime of the day And then you wander through on this beautiful plunge bath. And you just sit and just relax in this men-only area.